हेलो, वेलकम टू द लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन व्हीकल डायनामिक्स। टिल नाउ वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट एक्सेलरेशन परफॉर्मेंस। नाउ लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट ब्रेकिंग परफॉर्मेंस। डिस्कस अबाउट ब्रेकिंग परफॉर्मेंस। यू नो दैट द पर्पस ऑफ द ब्रेक्स इज टू स्लो डाउन और स्टॉप द व्हीकल एज डिजायर्ड बाय द ड्राइवर। Let us write the general equation for braking. Earlier, we have discussed the various forces acting on a car negotiating a gradient theta. So here, like force is mass into acceleration, we can also write it has mass into deacceleration. So here deacceleration is equal to sum of all the external forces which are opposing its motion divided by mass. Force at the front wheel, force at the rear wheels, the drag force, the gradient force divided by m. See, when it is acting in the forward direction, you can call this as a traction force. When acting in the opposite direction, you can call it as the brake force. So sum of all these forces is equal to mfxt, it is in the total forces in the x direction, divided by mass of the vehicle. That's what we are talking about, the deacceleration. Now let us find out, you know, what is the time required for the vehicle to stop. See, you know, deacceleration from the previous slide, we have written sum of all the external forces acting in the x direction divided by mass. This can also be written as minus dv by dt. Minus because it is deaccelerating, rate of change of velocity in the negative direction. Okay, from these two terms, keep dv on one side and you can cross multiply, we'll get this one. Let us say initially the vehicle is with the velocity v naught and vf is the final velocity. Final velocity can be some velocity or it can be zero also. Deacceleration rate I have taken out at v naught is the velocity at zero time and vf is the velocity after ts time. So by integrating, we are going to get this V naught minus Vf divided by Fxt by m into Ts. Now, in this equation, if I put, like, now from that previous equation, we can find out Ts, correct? Ts is equal to V naught by Vf by Fxt by m, or we can call it as dx. If I make final velocity equal to zero, then it becomes simply Ts is equal to V naught by dx. It is the time to stop the vehicle. Now, let us find out what is the stopping distance. Again, if you look at this equation, you take this, consider this equation. And V is nothing but rate of change of displacement. So dt is equal to dx by v. So we can substitute in place of dt here. Then once again, integrating, because I have to consider the distance to be covered. So 0 to x dx by v. Then after integration, I am getting x is equal to this. Okay. So from this, if Vf is final velocity that is going to be zero, then stopping distance is this one. So basically, stopping distance depends on deacceleration rate. Correct? So these are all very important in braking, because when the vehicle is running with a certain velocity, so now to avoid the obstacle, within what distance we should be able to stop it. So to stop within that distance, what should be the deacceleration rate? So if I apply brake to achieve the deacceleration, really what happens? This is what the question is. For that, it is necessary to understand this. Though the equations are simple, it is necessary to understand all these things. So initially, the vehicle will be running with the kinetic energy, let us say half me square, that is half m v naught square. So the final velocity is vf square. So what is the energy that is going to bring the vehicle from in a velocity v naught to vf? What is the amount of kinetic energy has to be absorbed? And this kinetic energy gets dissipated into heat. Correct. Or this is what you can call it as regeneration braking. Can we recover this kind of energy and charge the batteries? So that is what the power absorbed by the brake system. So here Vf is equal to zero if I make it. Then that becomes half m e naught square. So this is over the stopping distance Ts. If I divide this, then I'll be getting what is the power in kilowatt absorbed by the brake system. Now let us understand brakes, the types of brakes that we normally use in our vehicle system. Now, let us look at from this course point of view. What's the time in automobile? What are the types of brake systems that we use? When we use hydraulic power to apply brakes, then we call them as hydraulic brakes. If you make use of the vacuum power assist, then we can call it as power assisted brake or vacuum assisted brake. Sometimes we may use even compressed air as a power source for applying the brake. Then compressed air assisted brakes, they call it. Okay. Here is the braking fluid like that I use, then I can call it as air brake system like this. Whatever be the type of the system, in each brake system, you will have a tandem master cylinder, vacuum booster, vacuum pump, pressure control valves, and brake fluid reservoir. These are some of the components of the braking system. So let us look at simply a brake system. Correct. Now basically, as I mentioned, in a brake system, you will have a tandem master cylinder. Basically, you can say kind of a piston cylinder arrangement. Only thing is there are two pistons over here. Okay, they are in tandem. So these are the front wheels, the rear wheels. For each one of the wheel, we have provided a brake. Okay. So this is brake pedal. This is the place where we apply the brake or apply the effort. When you apply the effort, this gets transmitted to this. In the tandem master cylinder, we have brake fluid. And in this system, what we have done is we have connected two brakes to one part of the cylinder, another other two brakes for the other part of the cylinder. So the idea is that by chance one line fails, the other line should be working. That's from the safety point of view. So whenever we apply an effort, this plunger moves inside this, pressurizing the hydraulic fluid. So the pressurized fluid flow to the brakes. That means there will be in the brakes, there will be a brake cylinder. It will flow to that, and that in turn will apply the brake. Right. So here you have a brake fluid reservoir. So when we apply, like, this fluid will enter here, when we release again, the fluid will flow backwards to this. Also, you can observe in the rear line, rear brake line, we have certain valves called as G valve, load sensing proportionating valve, and why they are placed, what are the functions, I'll be explaining in the later slides. This is a simple brake system, manually operated, and of course we use the hydraulic power assist, hydraulic assist. Okay, this is the brake system we are talking about now. Now, I also mentioned this something like vacuum assist. Whatever system I explained earlier, that here the tandem master piston rod to this here, in between here we have introduced a vacuum booster. What is this vacuum booster? Basically, you can consider it's a hollow disc. Inside the disc, you can say there is a plunger. The whole idea here is this filled with air initially. Correct. So now, one side of this I have connected to the engine, say suction side, or I must have connected to a vacuum pump. So either during the induction system vacuum is created, that time it sucks out the air, or if I use the vacuum pump, it sucks out the air. So across this plunger, there will be low pressure here, there will be higher pressure here. Correct. So when I apply the effort to this effort, you will get, you see here, this resistance is reduced now. And moreover, it is a larger area. And whatever that pressure went to this area, that force, again what will happen, reduce, it gets amplified. This piston is smaller, amplified now. So the force gets amplified. So the pressure, it is easy, with less effort, it is possible for us to push this piston forward. So it is actually boosting or amplifying the force. That's why I call it as a vacuum booster. We just make use of the vacuum that is available in the induction system of an engine, or we might use a vacuum pump. Then this brake system, we call it as vacuum assisted brake. So what is the power amplification that happens? It's very easy to calculate. What is the pressure that is acting on this? What is the area? What is this area? What will be the pressure? And this easily we can calculate. So you have seen that brake circuits. Suppose from the master cylinder, I take one line and connect it to the front two wheels, another line and connect it to the rear wheels. Simply front and back split, I call it. But whenever we are up, when we apply the brake, due to some reason, if mechanically it fails, one of the lines fail, the other line will be there. So that will take care of the braking. So for safety sake. So here later, once you understand the brake dynamics and all that, is it right that I apply brake for both the front wheels and no brake force on the rear, or only on the rear, no brake force? What? So is it going to be stable? These kind of questions come into picture. So that's why, to avoid all that, some kind of instabilities that get created, to avoid that, normally they use X-split. That means from one of the cylinders, they take out the line. The line will be connected to the front as well as to the rear in the opposite diagonal direction, diagonally. So this way diagonally we connect these things. If a one line fails, one front brake and one rear brake will be right, will be braked. And of course, it will be, if you understand brake dynamics, and it will be more safer in this case. That is why X-split brake is very much preferred. So let us look at the brake components. Brake components. As I said, tandem master cylinder. What it does? It converts driver's foot effort to hydraulic pressure and transmits the pressure to wheel cylinder. That's what I said. You can very clearly see that this rod, yeah, maybe connected to the vacuum booster, that in turn connected to the pedal. That's fine. You can see there are two cylinders over here, one here, one line, another one here. You have a piston now. Here also you have a piston. Great. So when you push this piston, this oil gets pressurized and comes out. Again, this pressure will also act on this piston. This will also move forward and you will get this oil. Okay. So here are the reservoir. To this, you will get the oil like this. From here, it will split. Right? Like this, it will be there. When you release the brake, again the oil will flow backwards, right? Okay, fine. So that has been shown very clearly over here, right? So you can see that how the equalization happens about that. So how exactly a master cylinder works? Probably that video you can see on YouTube. Okay, right. Then we have wheel brakes. Let us talk about brakes. On each wheel, you will have one brake. So either the brakes can be drum brakes or they can be disc brakes. So you can see here, this is just a picture of drum brake. Okay, again, there are different designs of drum brakes will be available. Okay, simplex, duplex. Okay, so what are these things? I'll just explain in the next slide. Let us say this is, there is a drum brake. This is what you call it as brake liner. Okay, these are brake liners. On this you have the friction material. Here you will have the friction material. This is the drum, brake drum. So connected to the wheel, right? This is what you call it as wheel cylinder. Correct. From the master cylinder, the pressurized fluid will enter into the wheel cylinder. This will exert pressure on this piston. So when the pressure acts on this, this one will move in this direction, this will move in this, because they are hinged here. And they make a contact with the drum. So they arrest the rotation of the drum. So that's what happens in the drum brake. You see here, in this design, we have hinged both liners here. But in this case, one liner is hinged at the top, one liner is hinged at the bottom. And there are, instead of one wheel cylinder, you have two wheel cylinders over here. So one wheel cylinder will operate this brake liner, another one will operate this brake liner. So you can have another duo duplex. This is what the names are, right? This is another design. So for a long time, the drum brakes were in use. But nowadays in cars, the drum brakes are not being very much used. Instead of that, they are preferring disc brakes. The reason for drum brakes not being preferred, you have this friction material. When you apply the brake, this will rub against the drum. So actually what is happening, the vehicle kinetic energy has to be absorbed to stop the vehicle. So that is why we are applying this. That kinetic energy will be converted into thermal energy and gets dissipated. So when this kinetic energy gets converted into thermal energy, all these parts get heated up. So the temperature increases. Increase in temperature. Because of that, what happens between these two, when they come in contact, a brake force has to be created. For that, friction coefficient mu will be there. You should have some mu. The moment it starts rubbing, the mu value decreases. So brake force, if I consider mu, okay, mu into, let us say some force, let me call it as P something like that, just like that. So this is the force. This force, mu is reduced, then the brake force is reduced. Though you are applying the brake, the drum will not be arrested. So it continues to move. So that way, brake reliability will be a problem. Okay. So it may not stop at the required distance. It may take longer time to stop. This kind of difficulty will be there. The reduction of this mu, because of the increase in temperature, we call it as brake fading. That is popular. You want to avoid brake fading, means you have to continuously cool the brake. However, it is housed in a drum. It is difficult to circulate the air and cool these shoes or brake liners. Okay, this is what I explained already. What a wheel cylinder is. So other type of brakes that we consider are the disc brakes. So here you have the disc, you can see, and you have the brake system, right? It's basically, it is open to the atmosphere. You can continuously, since it's open to the atmosphere, as the car moves, continuously the air will flow over that, it will cool. So this is, there will not be much of fading effect here, brake fading effect. Not that it's completely eliminated, definitely for a small instant there will be fading effect, but because of the continuous cooling, the fading effect is very, very small. Now, this is the disc. and these are called parts. This is part, this is disc, this is caliper. So you can apply the brake so that the caliper will move, pushing this, and these brake pads come in contact with and apply the brake, the way it's shown over here. They come forward and they apply the brake. So to increase more brake force, instead of one part, you can use twin parts like this. Okay, so that the braking area will also increase, and you can definitely area and the force will increase. Here the caliper is moving. But you can also keep the caliper fixed. You can only make these parts move like this one, this piston move like this. Because of this pressure, this part portion will move forward, and the caliper is fixed in this case. So that's how we can apply the brakes over here. Okay, so again, you can watch the videos and how exactly the system work, we can understand. I mentioned about the brake booster, what's its purpose. Like you can see, that's another, once again, I opened it up, like you're removing the, connecting it to your vacuum pump or induction system, reducing the pressure so that you can easily move this. And whatever, you can amplify the force, that's the main thing. So the effort required here by the driver will reduce. You can have single vacuum booster, or you can have tandem brake boosters to increase the force and reduce the effort much more. Okay, these are the brake boosters. So this is what I have shown, is a vacuum pump, right? Simply suction side of the pump, if you connect, it'll create the required vacuum. So now let us study about braking forces. Here we discuss about brake forces. Now I just consider one of the wheels of the vehicle. Let us say W is the weight acting on this wheel. Now, you know, we get the wheel torque from the engine. Let us say TE is the torque developed by the engine. This torque gets multiplied by the gear ratio or the transmission. It further gets multiplied with final drive ratio. That is the torque that is available. Now, this is the torque that comes to the rear axle, say if it's a rear axle drive, and this is the torque making this wheel rotate, and this is the direction which the vehicle is traveling. Now suppose I apply a force here, and the normal to it, this is the, let us say, let us call this as the brake force. See here, we have the wheel cylinder. Let us say P is the oil pressure, A is the wheel cylinder area. Then P into A is the force that we are applying. When we apply this force, then the brake line make a contact with the drum, and it will create a brake force. The friction between the brake lining and the drum, let us assume it is mu p. So then mu b p a is the force that is acting. This force, let us call it as brake force. And this brake force with to the radius of this wheel is what you can call it as the brake torque. So mu b p a, or brake torque. So this force, brake torque, is acting in this direction. So what happens, by chance, if it is free will, it's hung at one point, and we are giving a torque in one direction, and we apply a reaction torque in the opposite direction, if these two torques are equal, then the wheel will stop spinning. By chance, if this torque is greater than this torque, then the wheel should start, the wheel should start rotating in this direction. But here in this case, it won't happen like that. This is connected to the drive line, this wheel. The torque is coming from the drive line. And if the brake torque, brake torque we apply, definitely not be able to rotate in the opposite direction. One more thing is this wheel, you have got a brake torque here. You have got the wheel torque here. There is one more force coming here. This wheel is in contact with the road. So W is the load that is acting on the wheel. Between the load and the road, there is a friction. Tire and the road surface, there is a friction. Let us call it as mu. So if it is moving in this direction, say this is the traction force in this direction. So brake force, traction force is here. Opposing to that, there is a brake force. Correct? Now, if this brake force is from the road, right? So we have to find some kind of an equilibrium. Correct. Suppose in this case, what happens, by chance the brake torque is greater, say brake torque is greater than say wheel torque, whatever it is, by chance it is there, this wheel gets locked up, it will start sliding on the road. So let us say that there are two forces now. One is the brake force and another one is the braking force. Correct. The brake force is, let us say mu b, p a, this is the brake force. And this r, this is the, brake torque. Right. So now this is the brake torque, so this brake force is greater than, brake force is greater than the braking force, that is mu w. Then what is going to happen, this wheel cannot rotate and this will start sliding on this one. Okay. So this is the torque, that is what's happening here in this direction. This is the torque and this torque is in this direction, right? The brake force mu w, if I write wind to r, it is a clockwise torque and is a counterclockwise torque. That's why I say if the counterclockwise torque is greater than the clockwise torque, then what is going to happen is this wheel will lock up and it cannot spin, so it will start sliding. You can call it as a skidding phenomenon, skids. So for that reason, what is important is mu b p a, or you can cancel both sides. So mu b p a must either be less than or at the most equal to mu w. But if this is equal to this, it will lock up. So you want to avoid lockup, it should be less than that. That is what is important. So now, let us look at these things. As I said, in a vehicle, you have four wheels like this, right? I said at a given instant, depending on the situation, load on each one of the wheel is different. Suppose it is taking a turn and you are braking. Initially, let us say the load is W front left. This is W front right. This is W rear left. This is W rear right. Like this. Let us assume the load was here 400 kg. Here it was 400 kg, here it is 300, here it is 300. This was the static load. Now when you start, you are taking a turn, load transfer happens like this. These two wheels load will increase, these two load will decrease. Then you are braking, then what happens is, okay, this will be minimum, right? Now braking means now again further load will transfer from rear to the front. So then what will happen? I think this wheel is the maximum loaded wheel and this one is the minimum loaded wheel like this. So the question is now the brake force that we apply for this wheel cannot be same as this wheel, like no, for these two, like all the wheels, the loads are different and the brake force to be different. If I apply the same brake force, probably based on this calculation, these three wheels may get locked. Okay, based on this calculation, if I do, they may not break at all. So this is the whole situation. Because you see here, it depends on load. So that is what really one of the most difficult thing is, that whenever the brake force, we call it as something like panic braking. It is not always, it will not happen. So when you are driving the car, so sometimes to avoid an obstacle or whatever it is, when the driver applies panic brake, there are chances that the brake force is greater than the braking force and the wheel may get locked up. Because of locking, what happens is, once these wheels get locked, it is difficult to steer the wheels. Then we lose control over the vehicle. This is the difficulty. So the whole essence is that we need to avoid locking. We need to avoid locking of these wheels. That is what is important. So that's what I said. Mu W must be greater than mu B P A. That's what's important here. Look here, by chance, when you apply the brake, the front wheels get locked up. So this is the brake force. When you apply this locking, brake force is applied. If this wheel get locked, they become like hinges. And that time, the reactions are created at the wheel surface, a kind of lateral force will be generated. And this lateral force, about the center of gravity, it will create a moment like this and try to keep the vehicle straight. Okay, this mechanism is like we deal in vehicle dynamics, right? So this is how we try to keep the wheel straight. By chance, rear wheels get locked up. Now again here also reactions generate, but what is happening here, these reaction forces about the center of gravity again, right, they are the vehicle. This is really dangerous. So whenever we, if at all locking happens, let it happen to the front wheels, not to the rear wheels. That way the brake designer will have a bias towards front brakes. Okay, we should not have any wheel lockup at all. In that fashion the brakes have to be designed, but if at all it happens due in unavoidable circumstances, let front wheels get locked up. So it's biased. So now what needs to be done? Look at these things. The requirement is mu b pa must be less than or equal to mu w. Less than or equal to mu w, here we have a wheel cylinder, this area of the wheel cylinder is fixed. Okay, this value is a fixed value. P is the variable. P is the variable. It is the mu, the given surface between the road and the wheel tire, and W is the load acting on the wheel. By chance, these are constant values. The only thing that we have P as the variable, which we can, if we can control and keep this value less than this value, wheel will not lock up. Okay, so let us look at these things. How do we avoid lockup using various technologies? That's why we do brake proportioning. So let me explain what exactly the brake proportioning is. As you have seen now, whenever we brake, load on the front wheels will be higher than the load on the rear wheels. Okay. From the master cylinder, we supply pressurized fluid to these, each one of these brakes. Correct. Each one of these brakes we supply. Now, but the question is here, when we are braking, the front wheels are loaded more than the rear wheels. That means the brake force that we have to supply to the front wheels must be higher than the brake force that we supply for the rear wheels. Correct? Brake force for the front must be greater than the brake force that we brake force of the rear. So it means to say, if the brake force, again if I am going to represent by mu b p a and all that, so mu b again p a, let me represent this p as now p f and this as p rear. That means the p f must be greater than p r. Suppose oil is coming with the same pressure from the master cylinder. So what you have to do is, whatever oil that brake fluid is getting into this line, before passing on to the brake cylinder, its pressure must be reduced, or we have to supply fluid at the low pressure. So if you know the front axle loading and rear axle loading, and definitely we can model this, load on the front axle and load on the rear axle, and various braking situation if we can, and depending on the load mu, if you can develop a characteristic or a model then for a given situation, if this is the brake force on the front, what is the corresponding brake force on the rear? We can find out. And once that brake force is known, and what should be the pressure of the fluid to the rear, we can find out. And once we know that pressure and we can control the hydraulic fluid to flow with that pressure, so that locking will not happen. Anyway, there are many proportionating modelings. Using those, we can model them, right? So then how do we implement this? To implement this, there are two types of proportionating valves they normally use. One is what they call it as pressure sensitive proportionating valve. Another one is called load sensing proportionating valve. So now if you see the brake lining like this, okay, you have this master cylinder here and you have the line to the front and is the line to the rear. You can see at this point in the line, the brake proportionating, pressure sensitive proportionating valve will be fixed. If you further open and see this, this is the master cylinder. Here you have the valve for the rear, and that is for the front line. This is for the rear line. Here in the line, you can see there is a puppet valve. In the normal condition, the brake fluid simply flows like this and brakes are applied like this. And when the brakes are released, again it will flow backwards like this. So there will be a spring holding this against this puppet valve, so that it will be in the relaxed position, so that there is a proper connection between these. Whenever a panic brake is applied, because of the pressure difference, higher pressure on side, so then what happens, this puppet valve move forward and partially closes this passage. When partially closes this passage, the quantity of oil flowing to the rear brakes will reduce and the pressure also gets reduced. It happens only during panic braking. Such a valve, we call it as pressure sensitive proportionating valve. There is also a load sensitive proportionating valve that will be connected to the body itself. I'll explain the concept here like this. When vehicle is running on a normal road, no brakes are applied, you can see the chassis position is horizontal like this. Whenever the vehicle is braked, the load gets transferred from the rear to the front, so this dives. Correct. This is the position I'm talking about. So let us say this is the brake fluid valve. When it is in the horizontal position, correct, it is in the open, this puppet valve will be in the open position. The fluid, brake fluid will flow like this and flows backwards depending on the requirement. But whenever you brake, a panic braking is done. So a large amount of load gets transferred to the front and the position changes. That position, when it changes, it pulls this lever up. And definitely what's going to happen like this, this is the shape it will take, and this valve moves forward and closes this passage, and the quantity of brake fluid flowing will reduce and pressure gets reduced. So chances of rear wheel lock up happening is reduced. So we are controlling only the rear wheel. As I mentioned, the designer is biased towards the front. Okay, we do not want rear wheels to get locked up. However, these proportionating valves not respond, may not do the proportioning very accurately. So even if you use these valves, there is chances of lockup. So how do we reduce this? Now there is what they call it as nowadays anti-lock braking system they use. That is what you call it as ABS. First, to understand ABS, please understand that the idea is to keep the pressure low. That's all the idea. We'll define slip. Why we need to do all this is, if I say mu b, say p r a wheel cylinder must be less than mu rod and weight of the wheel. Okay, right. So if we, by chance, if we can accurately find the value of load on the wheel, and also if you know the mu value, we can find out this magnitude, and you know this, and PR can be determined, and we can supply the oil at that pressure. But the whole issue is, it's quite difficult to find out now load on the wheel. Also, mu, it is difficult to measure. So somehow we have to measure this mu indirectly. And load on the wheel, if we can find, then it is possible to find PR. So for that reason, what we do is, we'll define slip now. Slip is V minus omega R by V. This is vehicle speed. This is wheel speed. Okay. If the wheel speed is zero, omega is zero, then slip is 1, that is 100%. Your wheel is not spinning, but the vehicle is moving. This is what we call it as the skid condition. But for any other value of omega, the slip is less than 100%. Okay, now we have relationship between braking coefficient, that is mu, and the wheel slip. This is for different types of road, dry road, wet road, okay, all these conditions we have. You can observe that it is right. If you test this, the mu value will be maximum when the wheel slip is around 20%. So for a given tire, we can get the mu value. And moreover, because of this high mu value, if you utilize, again stopping distance will also be reduced. So what is the idea here is, somehow if we can brake utilizing this effect, then we can avoid locking, we lock up, also we can decrease the stopping distance. So for that reason, this is what exactly ABS system makes use of. Okay, now let us look at the circuit, how it works. Now here you see wheel speed versus time curve. I have taken left, right, or right, right, left front, right front, all the four wheels. Let us say a vehicle is running with certain speed, Now I play brake. So I apply some kind of a panic brake. Panic brake, that's the idea. We can very clearly see that the vehicle speed is coming down. Now the speed of this wheel is coming down. If I continue to apply the brake, then what will happen? It will go like this. Then wheel speed will become zero. Its wheel speed up will become zero. Then the vehicle will lock up. But the vehicle speed is still there. So now what is that we can do? Yes. Let us say we have V omega R by V. We'll keep a mounted vehicle speed sensor on the vehicle and wheel speed sensor for each one of the wheel. We'll mount this. These let these sensors continuously measure the values of V, also omega, and supply these values here. Correct. So the moment we apply the brake, what happens? The slip will start increasing. Initially it will be zero slip. It will start increasing. Increasing. And the vehicle speed is changing. Omega is also changing. Then wheel speed reaches to something like, vehicle slip reaches to something like 20%. Further it is going down, means it will go right. So let us say 20 to 23%, something like this. So that is what exactly is happening, is about before going to lock. Now what you do is, you apply the brake, release the brake. When you release the brake, it will start coming backwards like this. Backwards coming like this. Again, slip is around 15%. So the wheel speed has increased. So again, you apply the brake like this. Okay. Release, it comes out like this. Then again you apply the brake, again you release, but you are playing with around 20% slip like this for each one of the wheels. You keep doing like this, then the wheel, finally the vehicle will stop without locking. This is what this, the unit which senses this vehicle speed, wheel speed, and accordingly apply brake and release brake, is what you call it as the anti-lock braking system. Okay, so this is what exactly the concept which I explained is shown in the diagram here. It happens only during panic braking. You can see here, it measures omega value, goes here. So according to the formula and the graph, it will see, and V omega R, and we calculate the slip, find the mu value, all this. Accordingly, it will send a control signal to the brake actuator to apply the brake or release the brake. Correct? This is disconnected now. Panic brake. Once this is done, once again it will come back to the control right. Okay, this is what the ABS system works, and it is will be active only during panic braking. So how exactly, you know, pressure regulation happens, all these are given. You know, your master cylinder, you see here the oil comes like this into this way. Yes. Correct. Now once when you want to apply this while may control, release this while may control like this. Okay, the same way for this, the other one, other wheel, front wheels. So these hydraulic, these are what solenoids, which valve to apply, which valve to release. Based on that instructions that are coming from the ECU, it will be done. Okay, so for four wheel, the same ABS system is shown, wheel 1, wheel 2, wheel 3, wheel 4 and all that. Then input circuitry, then microcontrollers, which will do these. These microcontrollers in turn will send the signals to the actuators. So they will decide whether to operate the hydraulic system or applying the brake or releasing the brake will be carried out. But all the system is communally, this is what you can call it as your ECU system, right? Like, I hope you understood this. Signals are, you see here, this wheel speed sensor coming there. And we have to feed the vehicle speed sensor. Okay. So it's not shown here. Vehicle speed also should get in there. Then calculation will be done in the microcontrollers. And these micro, after calculations and all that thing, send signals to these actuators. The actuators in turn control the hydraulic system. The hydraulic actuators will open or close depending on the signal that is coming from here. Okay. So for each individual wheel, a separate line. Earlier we were controlling with two lines, rear and front and all that, now individual. So each wheel's load, if you know, we can do that. Now how do we do that? We can use EBDF system. What is that EBDF? As I said, now mu indirectly we can predict using the slip, by measuring the slip. Another one, if I can measure the vehicle load. How do you measure the vehicle load? Suppose static load in the front minus W by G, sorry, W, AX by G, H by L, correct, for the front means plus. Similarly, I can write the equation for the lateral load transfer. So that means to say, this is known to us, this is known, this is known, this is known, this is known. Here, you will get AY. Here also W, AY, H, instead of L, you will get T. This is the track width. Okay. So all these things are known, AX, AY. So that means if I can measure lateral acceleration, sorry, linear acceleration of the vehicle, lateral acceleration of the vehicle, then I can substitute all those acceleration values into this, get that load. I know that load, I know mu. Now I can control what should be the pressure of that value. So if you can have this to this microcontroller, vehicle speed is connected. You can see here, lateral acceleration, linear acceleration, using accelerometers if I can measure. Wheel speed is also known. Slip is known. So I know mu from the curve. Mu, and I can calculate W now from this formula. I know this. Then I can calculate mu B, P. Okay. For the given wheel, I can calculate A. I know this, what should be the pressure of the oil to be sent to the wheel if I know. Yes. Now I actuate the pump to supply the oil at that pressure. And that pressure sensor, from the pressure sensor, I get the feedback. So I can do this. This is what electronic brake force distribution is. EBDF. Okay. now almost 1 in 1,000,000 chances I can will be there. That's all the thing. Locking up chances are 1 in 1,000,000. That's all the thing. So that is the idea behind breaking. Hope you understood the concepts of break, advanced anti-lock braking system, break proportioning, and EBDF systems and all. So now you can watch, like there are ABS variants available, and there are many videos available on ABS system on YouTube. You can watch and understand these things. Hope you enjoyed this. Thank you very much.